Even after 10 years, I just learned iPhone can do this. So here are 10 tips I just learned, like what even is this screen, quick actions you can take on screenshots I had no idea about, tips for sending audio messages, scan text anywhere you're typing on your phone, powerful options for battery widget, and one tip I'm gonna use in Safari all the time. First, let's talk about what even is this screen. Now, full credit, I learned this from Michael Caputo, who also has an incredible YouTube channel, and I met him at the Miami Apple Store opening, but totally subscribe to his channel too. I'll put that down in the description. But this screen actually lets you adjust certain things about the camera and microphone when your phone is recording. Now, if you're just on the home screen or the microphone and camera are not active, you actually won't see this screen. You can see what apps have accessed your camera recently, like Instagram, but you won't get all those options. But if you go into an app like Instagram and you actually go to record, so the camera's open, you see the little green dot appear here in the dynamic island. Now, if you swipe down from Control Center, at the very top, you'll see the apps currently accessing your camera or microphone. If you tap that, not only will you see the privacy section, but you'll see these options to actually adjust how your iPhone is capturing video and audio. For instance, you can enable or disable portrait mode and even adjust the depth at which it's going to be blurring that background. Also for studio light, whether you want it on or off, all of those are options. Plus for the audio settings, you can choose voice isolation, which is actually really powerful and cuts out background noise, echo, focuses on your voice, or wide spectrum, where it will capture more of the audio and less focused specifically on your voice. Now, weirdly, if you go to Apple's stock camera app, so let's say it's open, let's even go over to record a video. If I swipe down from the control center, I can tap here and you don't get those same options. I guess because Apple wants you to change it specifically here in the camera app, but you should see those options when you open other video capturing apps, even things like Snapchat. So here I am in the Riverside app, and if I tap here in control center, you'll see I get those options again, whether I want to enable voice isolation, portrait, and more. Had no idea this screen existed. All right, number two, if you were taking screenshots and wanted to share someone, I would typically tap it, expand it, then hit the share button, maybe text it, airdrop it, or email it. But you can actually skip that screen entirely. Next time you take a screenshot, just tap and hold on the preview down here in the bottom left. And when you let go, the share sheet's gonna come right up and you can text it or do whatever you would like. Then you can skip that whole preview window. Another screenshot tip, you might remember that when you took screenshots in iOS 17 and before, you can go into markup mode and there was a magnifier option here, but you see that's no longer available. You have add shape and opacity, but there is a secret way to get that magnifier back, which can make a part of your screenshot bigger. Tap the share button on a screenshot and then go over to Apple Books. If you still don't see books, you might need to save it to your photos, then go over to your Photos app, tap the share button, and now you should see Apple Books in that list. There it is. Now the screenshot will actually open in Apple Books automatically, and here you actually get slightly different markup tools. When you tap the pencil icon and now hit the plus, you'll see that magnifier option is back. Tap magnifier, and that's gonna give you a little circle on screen, so you can put it over an icon, or maybe I wanna draw attention to the podcast artwork for Primary Technology. That's my tech podcast, you should definitely subscribe, link is in the description. Then you can change how large the magnifier is, and you can rotate this point around the circle to decide how much you're going to zoom in. You can even tap this icon here and add more of a border around the magnified area. I wish that was still in the stock screenshot tools, but you can at least do it in Apple Books. Then once you mark it up here, you can go to that document, tap in it, hit the menu icon here, and then you'll get a share button to share that marked up screenshot. Number four, you can OCR text with the camera on your iPhone for text in the real world and bring it into an app. Now, let's say you were in Apple Notes. Here it's a little different. You would actually tap the paperclip icon here, and then you'll see the scan text option. Tap that, and you'll see the camera preview is now at the bottom. Put the text you want to OCR in that preview and tap the blue button, and now it will insert, and the font messed it up a little bit, but you'll see it got movies on the soon. But you can also do this even if you don't have that paperclip icon in Notes. Let's say you were in a text message and you wanted to scan text here. We'll just tap wherever the cursor is, tap autofill, and then you'll see the scan text option. Tap scan text, and you'll see the keyboard transition to that camera again. Point your camera at whatever text you want to insert, tap the blue insert button, and it will pop in where your cursor was. While we're here in message, number five has to do with audio messages. Now, I don't send these very much, but if you wanted to record something and send it to someone, you'll see the little record going here, I'm speaking. Then when you tap stop, maybe you forgot to add something or say something, you might need to think you need to record again. Well, you can actually just tap this little plus icon next to the seconds that you already recorded, and when you tap that, it'll go back into recording mode. This way you can take a break or pause and then add more audio to the message before you send it. You can do this multiple times, stop and then start again, and then when you're ready, you can finally send the message. And remember, for those of us who don't listen to audio messages, you do get a full transcript of that recording now with iOS 18. Number 6 has to do with the battery widget. Now, I don't have my battery percentage here in the status bar, it's just battery stress for me. But you might want it here on your lock screen, especially if you leave always on display mode. Well, you can do that by customizing your lock screen, tapping over, and then adding the battery widget. I'll go down to the battery section here. Remember, you get the single slot or the dual slot battery percentage. I'll do that, and you can see by default it's showing me my Apple Watch. But while I'm still here in edit mode, tap on it again, tap on the widget again, and now instead of showing automatically whatever device the phone thinks I want, I can turn off automatic and then choose what device where I want to show the battery percentage. That includes my Apple Watch, but also AirPods or my phone's battery. But maybe I want to know what my AirPods charge is at whenever my phone is locked. Now I can see that right here on my lock screen. And you'll actually see that even if you have the wallpaper turned off for always on display. All right, number 7, this was a huge deal for me when I discovered it. When you go to Safari, you might have many tabs open. I have a few more open than I would like, and a great way to organize them is to move them into tab groups. Well, having to do that page by page can be pretty cumbersome. It's also not immediately obvious how to do that. If you're looking here at a web page, you would think it's in the share button, but it's not there. You actually tap over here and then tap the three dots here on the right, and then you get the move to tab group option there. Lots of taps, not very obvious. But instead, you can actually move multiple tabs at the same time. Create a tab group first. I have a couple tabs here about Hans Zimmer concerts in my area. So I'm actually going to tap here, which shows me all my tab groups. And while you can create a new tab group with all the tabs you have open, you probably want to organize it a little more. So I'm going to choose new empty tab group, and let's just call it Hans. I'll tap save, and obviously there's nothing in there right now, but I'll go back over to my main tabs, tap and hold on one of the tabs you want to move to that group, start moving it around like you would the apps on your home screen, and then you can tap other tabs, and they will all gather together. You even see the little number there. Then you can move all of these to a tab group at the same time. With my finger still on the screen holding the tabs here, I'll navigate to the tab group I just created, let go, and now I've moved the tabs to this tab group that fast. I had no idea that you can tap and hold on multiple tabs here in Safari and then move them to a group at the same time. And remember, you can tap and hold on that tab icon in the bottom right and close all your tabs at the same time. And if you're in the hundreds of tabs, it might be time to declare tab bankruptcy. Just saying. Next up, this is a simple but welcome new feature in iOS 18, which is calculator history. If you're doing calculations here in the calculator app, and maybe you swiped up, maybe you even swiped and closed the app, which you shouldn't do. I have a whole video why you shouldn't do that. You should watch it above. But if you go into the calculator app, there's now a menu here in the top left corner. Tap that, and you'll see your entire history of calculations right here. And you can go back pretty far, even to last year. So calculator history, very welcome. Number 9, if you were downloading some large apps, or maybe you're restoring your iPhone from iCloud and it's trying to download a bunch of apps at the same time, you can actually prioritize downloads so the app you want first is downloaded first. I'm going to install a couple big apps here. These are games from Apple Arcade. And then I'm going to swipe up to go home, go over to the app library, and then go to Recents. Now you'll see different apps already downloading, and if I tap and hold on one, I can prioritize that download. Then the iPhone should focus on downloading this one before other apps. And remember, you can also pause download if you want to make sure nothing else is taking up your bandwidth and it can just focus on that one. And you also don't have to wait for it to completely download to delete it. You can just cancel the download midstream and that app is gone. Number 10, if you're looking for settings here in the settings app, there is the search bar up at the top, but a lot of times that can be a little cumbersome and doesn't show results right away. Plus it just shows a bunch of different results that might not be useful. I would instead search for settings right here from the home screen. If you swipe down on the home screen to open Spotlight and start typing a setting like Bluetooth, you might actually see those settings appear here in results, and you might even get a toggle so you don't even have to go to the settings app to adjust it. That's also great for hotspots, so if you start searching for hotspot, you can jump to those settings right here, and so I actually find searching for settings in the home screen Spotlight is even more valuable than in the settings app. All right, a couple bonus tips. If you have a bunch of notifications, or maybe there's just an app being aggressive with notifications on a particular day, swipe on that notification here on your lock screen or notification center, tap Options, and now you can mute notifications from that specific app for an hour, mute it for the rest of today, or you can even turn off notifications without even going into settings. Great way to manage those notifications, especially if an app is being a little aggressive. But I do need this reminder because I'm adding my shortcut of the week to my community, which if you didn't know and you're into iPhone automation and shortcuts, I have an entire private community where almost 1,400 people have joined. We talk about shortcuts, smart home, and if you support the community with $5 a month, you get access to my shortcuts of the week, where I have a shortcut that pulls recipes from the captions in Instagram Reels or TikToks. I have another shortcut that automatically pulls a new wallpaper from Unsplash. I actually recently redid this wallpaper shortcut, and you only get access when you support my community. And those are shortcuts not found in my videos. So you can join at create.beard.fm, and I would appreciate your support, $5 a month, and you get access to my shortcuts of the week, my shortcuts GPT, which I've specifically trained to use with shortcuts. It's great at implementing APIs from websites you might want to integrate with. Plus, you get priority shortcuts request, and I answer and comment on every request and do my best to fulfill it. Again, that's create.beard.fm. And one more bonus tip, I had no idea. If you use reminders, which I do for a lot of things, and you wanted to share a list, but not to collaborate, let's say you had a Kanban board of ideas and you wanted to share it, well, tapping the share button and then here will actually invite someone to collaborate. And that means they can make changes to it. Instead, tap the three dots and go to print. Now, you're not actually going to print it, but it's going to put all the reminders from that list in a document. You can pinch out, and here you'll see the PDF format, and then just tap the share button here, and you can send this to someone, but it's just a PDF. They won't have access to actually change your reminders or collaborate on that list. So let me know down in the comments, were one of these tips new for you like it was for me? And if you have a tip that maybe I've never covered on the channel, leave that in the comments too. Don't forget to subscribe and hit that like button. Of course, iPhone tips, shortcuts and automation, tech reviews, and iOS 19 is going to be coming out in just a month. WWDC is very close, and I'm going to be covering all the new changes across all Apple's platforms. And if you want to see one of my latest shortcut videos, I'll put it right up here. Or if you're looking for 25 plus productivity tips for iPhone, you can check out my video on that right up here. Thanks for watching. I'll catch you next time.